First type of naming that we want to look at is naming binary compounds that contain a metal. And this is going to be type one. There are two types of naming when it comes to binary compounds that contain a metal. Binary compounds are compounds that contain two atoms. So we're generally going to be looking at two atoms. We will look then and start to include also polyatomic ions. Whenever we write chemical formulas, let's remember a couple of things. First, we always write the symbol of the elements that are in the compound. And then we use a subscript to indicate the number of atoms of that element within a compound, such as H2O, two hydrogens, and one oxygen. Now, when we're dealing with metals and nonmetals form what are known as ionic compounds. Ionic compounds are held together by the charge of the positive cation, the metal, being attracted to the negative anion, the nonmetal. Certain elements have common charges that they will have any time that they are an ion, and these are charges we need to know. As you go across the periodic table, the alkaline metals are going to be plus one when they're an ion. The alkaline earth metals will be plus two. The aluminum family metals will be plus three. The nitrogen family nonmetals will be negative three. The oxygen family nonmetals will be negative two. The halogens will be negative one. And within the transition metals, there are two that will have always the same charge. Silver, always plus one, and zinc, always plus two. If you look at this chart here to see all of that, that actually includes cadmium also as a plus two, but we don't use that nearly as frequently. So alkaline metals, plus one. Alkaline earth metals, plus two. Aluminum, plus three. Gallium and indium can be included with that. The nitrogen family nonmetals, nitrogen, phosphorus, negative three, oxygen, sulfur, negative two, the halogens, negative one, and then you see zinc and silver there. So we need to know this chart so that we know the common charges when we use those elements. So we're going to be putting together the compound based on those charges and coming up with a neutral compound. When you name an ionic compound, we name the individual ions within the compound. We do not use any prefixes such as mono, di, tri. And we add an IDE ending on the end of binary compounds. So if it's two elements bonded together, the second element will get an IDE ending at the end of the compound. So drop the ending of the element and change it to IDE. So let's look at some examples of this. Sodium fluoride. Sodium is Na. Fluoride, fluorine, F. We know Na is plus one. Fluorine is minus one. We want to put these together in a way that balances out the charges so that they are neutral. So since there's one positive and one negative, sodium fluoride would be NaF. Magnesium oxide. Mg is 2 plus. O is 2 minus. Equal positives and negatives, so we just use one of each, MgO. Aluminum sulfide, Al is 3 plus, sulfur is 2 minus. In this case, I need an equal number of charges, and the smallest number I can get to that's equal will be 6. So I need 2 aluminums and 3 sulfurs. Now, a common thing that you can do is crisscross these numbers. 3 sulfurs, 2 aluminums, 3 sulfurs, as we crisscross those numbers, just make sure that it's always the simplest ratio. If you crisscross these two, 2 and 2, that's not the simplest ratio. 1 and 1 is the simplest ratio. Calcium nitride, calcium 2 plus, nitrogen 3 minus, so you would have Ca3N2. Potassium phosphate. Now we have the ATE ending. Anytime you see an IDE ending, you know it's an element. If you see an ATE, ITE ending, you know it's a polyatomic. These are the polyatomics we've memorized. K, which is plus one for potassium. Phosphate is PO4, 3 minus. So I need K3PO4. Barium carbonate, Ba2+, carbonate, CO3, 2 minus. So BaCO3. Now, with the polyatomics, I didn't have an example in this case, but if we used more than one polyatomic, we have to put that polyatomic in parentheses and then put a number on the outside. So let's say, just to add another example, what if we had calcium phosphate? Calcium is plus 2, phosphate is 3 minus, so we would need Ca3, we would need 2 PO4, so we would put PO4 in parentheses and the subscript 2 on the outside. And this last one, ammonium, NH4 plus, chloride, Cl minus, so it's NH4Cl. So that's going name to formula. Now let's go formula to name. Ki. K is potassium. I is iodine. So we change the ending to IDE, so potassium iodide. Mg, magnesium. This is phosphorus. I'm going to change phosphorus to phosphide. Sodium, fluoride. Aluminum, nitride. The ID ending for the element, if you say nitrate or nitrite, you know it was the polyatomic. The IT or AT ending. Calcium oxide. Strontium chloride. And finally, potassium sulfide. If it were a polyatomic, we would not change the ending, but for any element, we change the ending to IDE. So this is what happens when we name binary compound, two elements, or an element and polyatomic ion, bonded together based on their charge, their ionic, metal with nonmetal. Anytime you have a metal with nonmetal, you follow these rules. And these are all metals that we know the charge of, that have a common charge, such as the alkaline metals being plus 1, the alkaline earth metals being plus 2, the aluminum family being plus 3. Or zinc being plus 2, silver being plus 1. If it's one of those, it falls into these type 1 rules. If it's an element that doesn't have a common charge, such as copper, iron, any of those transition metals that we are to commonly deal with, or some of the metals at the bottom on the right-hand side of the table, such as tin or lead, then we're going to need a second type of naming, which we'll get to in the next video.